So let's welcome team leader for JLCP Treinamentos e Serviços MTI Brazil, Robert Silva. Welcome.
Hello, my name is Robert Silva. I am tech lead at JLCP. I am also Zabbix expert and the Zabbix trainer. Today, I am going to talk about scaling Zabbix with containers. I will share with you my experience in deploying Zabbix using containers and the Docker Swarm. Let's start. The first time that I have used Docker in a project was a challenge. The Zabbix environment needed to prepare to monitor more than 3,000 new values per second, and it had to be fault-tolerant, resilient, and be able to scale the environment horizontally. All of these prerequisites were important to design the architecture. There are 5 ways to install Zabbix: using packages, compiling, using Docker, using cloud, or using applies. However, to install an environment that allows Zabbix to be fault-tolerant is more complex. To process, we use virtual machines or physical servers to install Zabbix directly on the operation system. In this scenario, it is necessary to install the operation system, update the system, and make tuning to improve performance. After it, we must install Zabbix, configure the backup of the configuration files and the database. However, there are some new issues with this type of installation. For example, when we have unavailable services, Zabbix server is down, frontend is down, what do we need to do to fix this problem? Then, we have the usual solutions. Human intervention is required to restart a service, restart a server, and in some cases create a new instance or even restore the backup. This is not enough. We need more. We don't need to assign someone to basic actions like this. The services must be able to establish themselves. To create a more intelligent environment, we can use some standard solutions. For example, the use of CoreSync and Pacemaker. These technologies are known as standard solutions. However, there are better solutions for high availability of CoreSync and Pacemaker. Today, I want to talk about high availability of database. There are native solutions for it. Today, we are going to talk about a new approach, the deployment of Zabbix using modern technologies, such as Docker, Docker Swarm, Reverse Proxy, Git, and as a bonus, CI/CD. Let's start by talking about the architecture of project. The architecture of project was divided into some components. I am going to explain its component by talking about its function inside our architecture. Let's start with HTproxy. HTproxy is responsible for receiving incoming connections and directing them to the nodes of the Docker Swarm cluster. For example, in each attempt to access the Zabbix frontend, the requests will be sent to the HTproxies, and it will detect where there is a service listening on the port 8, and it will redirect the request. Here we have a demo of when we access the address frontend.domain. We have sent a request to the HTproxies address, and it checks which nodes are available. This is very important. If a node is unavailable, the HTproxy won't route requests to it anymore. The HTproxy configuration file is called HTproxy.cfg. Let me show you this example. The configuration is divided in two steps, front-end and back-end. Let's use the traffic service as an example. In the backend, we define which servers are running the traffic services. We set some parameter as the check mode, the server's address that runs the applications, and which port is listed. In the front-end, we configure the port, we will get the communication, and we associate a backend to it. In this other example, we have set three hosts where the Zabbix service can run. Don't worry, we only have one Zabbix server container running, and we will cover this later. Now, let's talk about the NFS. We can use the NFS server or another service as the cloud file storage. This service is responsible for sharing and storing the files between the cluster swarm nodes. It ensures that if any Docker host is unavailable, the others are going to have a copy of these files. In this example, there are the necessary commands to configure the NFS server and NFS client. After installing the packages, you just need to follow these steps so the NFS can work and share the files to the clients. Now, let's talk about the host, Docker, and the Docker Swarm. These components are responsible for running and orchestration of the containers. The swarm consists of one or more nodes. The cluster members of Docker Swarm could be of two types. Managers, they are responsible for managing the cluster and control where the container should be executed. And workers, they are responsible for performing the service workloads. It's important to know that in the swarm, the managers can also perform workloads. Another essential component from this architecture is the reverse proxy. It is responsible for receiving the connections HTTP and HTTPS, identify the destination address and route it to the responsible containers. And it also does the load balance in case of too many happens. They're more commonly used reverse proxies or Nginx and Traefik. In this example, we have three containers running Traefik, one in each host Docker. After receiving the connection from the HTTP proxies, it will search for the destination container and send the package to it. Now, we know how each component works and what is its function inside the architecture. Let me show how to set this resource using the compose file. Before that, let me explain what the compose file is. The compose file is a file with a YAML extension that has services, volumes, and networks definitions within it. It is in this file that we define, for example, which image of Zabbix server can use, what network the containers are going to connect to, what are the service names, among other necessary settings to the service creation. In this slide, I share an example of configuration for reverse proxy using Traefik. First line, we have Traefik. This is mean the name of the service, okay? After it, we have image. In this option, we define which this image we can use. Here, we can define, for example, using Traefik, but we can change for using another version of Traefik, okay? And in deploy parameters, we have rules of how to this deploy must be created. For example, in constraints, where we can deploy it. For example, just deploy in nodes that's really equal manager. And in replicas, we define how many replicas for this service we can create. In restart policy, define which policy we can use if these services have a problem. For example, Traefik, Zabbix server, frontend, Zabbix proxy is unavailable. What's this Plurly, we can use it for restart and create a new services for try fix this problem. Okay? And in labels, we define labels specified for traffic. For example, define that traffic is enabled, define that a load balancer, define routers, and define a rule of the host. This host is named that you can use it for code this service. For example, for access traffic from change, we must be using Zabbix-traffic.mydomain. Here, we can define, for example, how to configure authentication for dashboards, the traffic, and define how to redirect all HTTP connections to HTTPS. Okay? And here, we have comment. This comment will be executed after container is started. For example, I will apply API equal true, blog.level equal info, and define that Docker is provider endpoint using Unix SOC. Define too that Docker Swarm mode is enabled, and define, for example, endpoints web and web security. Here we have an example for using Zabbix server. We define this name of the server. In this case, we called the Zabbix server, Zabbix-server, using image Zabbix/Zabbix-server-MySQL, and using image with version CentOS-5.0-latest. It means that I am using the latest image of the 5.0 version. Okay? And then in this case, we can use an environment file. In this environment file, we define, for example, database address, database username, database password, how many pullers I will start for pullers, trappers, how path for stern script, alert scripts, and the another options that we can define in Zabbix-server.conf in this common installation using operation system, for example. All configurations of Zabbix server configuration file is defined in this environment file. And in this case, use networks monitor networkings. In this case, we use two volumes for store stern script and the alert scripts. Okay, that scripts must be stored in NFS server, and the NFS server share this directory, and in host, in Docker host, we using this share for assigned to container. Okay? And here define to which port Zabbix server is listed. In this case, I have a redirect and then host port to container port. Here we can use an anchor YAML that's define templates of deploy and define in labels that traffic.enable is equal false. Okay, for Zabbix server, traffic is not enabled. And for front end, we have another options. For example, using image, in this case, using Alpine version, and in this case, use two. Env file, okay, and they define monitor networks, define deploy using anchor YAML, and here we have some options different. For example, in Zabbix front-end, we define 5 replicas, which is mean that we can start 5 Zabbix front-end. It's more scale, okay, and we can use it for big environments. And we have 5 containers for received connection for API, for Grafana, and for users. Okay? And here we have some labels. For example, traffic is enable equal true, and define that routers for front end. This name Zabbix-front-end, it means service name for traffic. Okay? And define that TLS must be using, and define front-end host. In this case, for access the front-end, we can use name front-end.domain. if we use different name, front-end is not accessed, okay? And define two that we can use into point web and web security. And the last line, we have load balancer server dot port equal 88. It is mean that it's port that container is listing, okay? And the official images of Zabbix front-end is listed in this port. Okay, now that we already know how to set each service, let me talk about the deploy. Until now, the deploy has been done manually. We need to connect to one of the servers with Docker Swarm Manager function and access the directory shared by the NFS. We should type the command to the deploy of our stack. We can use docker stack deploy dash c docker dash compose dot yaml zabbix. Dot c defines the name of the file of the compose file, and zabbix is the name of the stack. You can choose, for example, Zabbix underline prod, Zabbix underline dev, and another name. It was a big challenge to get to this standard configuration and deploy. And I would like to share some lessons. About Docker official images from Zabbix, it is normal to start by using them. However, it is important that you understand that they are not enough by themselves. In a production environment, we need to install additional packages. For example, install Python to run a specific script, install drivers or GPC to monitor a database, and you should learn how to work with Dockerfile and understand how to create your own custom images. About networks, you should be very careful when creating an environment using Docker. The Docker environment has some internal networks and they can conflict with your physical network. You must define network handling for using in Docker Network Overlay and the Docker Network Bridge. Now, I will show you an example of how to customize the Zabbix image to install the OGBC drive. In this example, we define the first part for our custom image. For example, we define in the first line args. In this args, we define Zabbix underline daisy and the Zabbix underline first. When build this image, we can define how image base, for example, we choose it for Alpine, for Ubuntu, and another version available. Okay? And then you can choose two Zabbix underline version. And if you can use Zabbix 4.4, we can choose this arg and build your image. Okay? And from is a base image, we can use the Zabbix Proxy SQLite 3. Okay? And we define environment variables. For example, Oracle underline home, LED underline library, and path. Okay? Below, we install OGBC drivers. For example, we copy drivers from my machine and the copy script odbc.sh. This script install its component for using odbc drivers for Oracle, MySQL, PostgreSQL, and SQL Server. Okay? After it, we have another part of this file. Here, we show how to install some packages. For example, we call requirements file and change word gear and install repel release, Python 3, Python 3 pip, and install requirements from pip. And after it, we install net-smdp utils, net-smdp, Dable Gets, Vim, Telnet, and Crashout. Okay? And with this image, we can monitor databases, network devices, HTTP agents, and of all options of the Zabbix. Its image now is complete. After customizing your image, there are three steps. Do the build of the image, do the push to the registry, and do deploy of the services. This process is manual and must be automated. Now, we are going to talk about the bonus. You should use CI/CD so you don't need to run the manual actions in order to create your image and to deploy your services. In this case, I have used GitLab CI/CD. It is a simple process, but it needs your attention. You must follow these steps. Create a repository for each component, for example, for Zabbix server, for frontend, for Zabbix proxy, and among the others. Enable the pipelines. Create a file called gitlab-ci.yaml. Here we have an example of how we can create a GitLab CI YAML file. Here we have an example of we can create a GitLab CI YAML file. Let me explain a little about this file. We have some parts. First part, we can define general variables. Okay, I define CI underline registry. This variable store my registry address and define which version I will use for Zabbix. And I use it for Zabbix server, frontend, Zabbix proxy. After it, I define build step. In the build step, I will create my custom image. I define the services, define the four scripts. In my case, I install curl in my runner from GitLab CI and run docker login for connect in my register. After it, I define script. In script, I define the line command line of build my image. For example, I use docker build, build args, and define some args. For example, Zabbix underline version, and define 5.0, 4.4, and another versions. And define another args. For example, build dates, build tag, okay? And I do a push for my registry, okay? And build the image and the push to the registry. And we define some options. For example, this is can run just only. I define the my branch and define, for example, if I have changes in Docker file and the external script director or in .gitlab-ci.yaml file, okay? And in general, I define variables, define build, define steps from my build, for example, build and push, okay? And that's it, totally automatic, okay? And here I define a little example for deploy and define a stage deploy and define a before script. I set Zabbix environment project, it is a label in my cluster swarm, and the do login in my registry, okay? And define script. In my script, I run docker stack deploy with registry out and the --- compose - file, it is some defined -c, okay? And define my stack name. For example, in this case, I define the Zabbix underline CI comp half slug. CI comp half slug, it is mean that I use branch name. For example, prod, dev, QA, and another names. Okay? And define the tags where this run must be run. Define that only use this deploy a branch prod. And define this deploy when manual. Okay? It means that I need to connect front-end in GitLab CI/CD and press button for start my deployment. So, that's it. In this final moment, I would like to share some benefits of using this architecture. If any component of Zabbix is unavailable, the Docker Swarm will automatically try to create a new service until the component is available again. You will no longer need to connect to your server terminal to the environment deploy. It makes the deploy and the administration simpler. That's it, all that I want to share with you. Thank you. See you later.
Thank you, Robert, for a really great use case. I've been wondering about these kinds of deployments myself, and actually I'm definitely going to go back to YouTube and just go through your stream once again at my own pace and see if I can kind of implement it in my own environment. But we have a couple of questions for you, so let's take a look. Do you think that this Docker approach can be used for extremely large instances? Maybe there are any setbacks that you can see in such use cases?
Yes, I think yes. Today we have some customer where I monitor more than 90,000 NVPS with more than 50 proxies, and have a big environment using DocSwarm with deploy GitLab CI/CD.
Okay, well, those are like really insane environments. So yeah, that sounds very promising. All right, great, wow. Then next up, we have a question, not directly related to your presentation, but do you think it's possible, and maybe what are the negatives and positives of setting up a similar environment with Kubernetes?
Yes, I think yes, but when we deploy Zabbix with Kubernetes, we don't use all functionality of Kubernetes. For example, Zabbix is not ready for scale. In Kubernetes, we can configure, oh, I need to scale more Zabbix server if I have used more virtual memory or CPU. Mm-hmm. But Zabbix is not scale in this moment. I think that using Docker Kubernetes is more complex than DocSwarm, but it's possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's possible, but you think that Docker Swarm is just more simple to set up and get going. Mm-hmm. Got yes. It. All right, thank you a lot. Like I said, very, very nice presentation, and definitely stick around in the chat, in the Q&A. I bet you'll receive quite a lot of questions about such implementations. Docker is very popular with our community, and I myself keep getting tons of questions during our webinars and so on. So prepare to answer quite a few of those.